Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Anselm, A Very Short Introduction, by Thomas Williams, narrated by Shea Taylor. Chapter 1. Anselm's Life, Work, and Contexts. In September of 1092, a 59-year-old Benedictine abbot, well known for his theological acumen and his spiritual guidance to kings, nobles, priests, and monks, found himself in England, attending to the overseas dependencies of his abbey in Normandy. It was a somewhat tricky time for Abbot Anselm to be in England, because he was, in the eyes of many, the obvious successor to his former teacher, Lanfranc, as Archbishop of Canterbury. And Anselm did not want to appear to be angling for the job. Nonetheless, his business in England was pressing, and so he went. Lanfranc had died more than 3 years earlier in May of 1089, but the king, William II, had not appointed anyone to succeed him. It suited the king to keep bishoprics vacant so that he could use church revenues to fund his military operations in Scotland and Wales. He felt no urgency about naming a new archbishop until March 1093, when he fell ill. Fully expecting to die, he wanted to get right with God and the church while he had time. The royal court was then at Gloucester, and, as it happened, Anselm's business in England had taken him to a village nearby. So Anselm was summoned to administer last rites and hear the king's confession. It may be that a promise from the king to fill the vacant archbishopric was a condition of absolution. We can't really know that part. But certainly the topic arose, and the king immediately named Anselm as his choice. Anselm was horrified. He begged, pleaded, wept, protested. His biographer tells us that Anselm's nose bled from the stress, but to no avail. The king and bishops, even Anselm's own retinue, insisted that he accept. Anselm clenched his hand to avoid receiving the pastoral staff that the king was trying to thrust upon him, so the bishops pried his fingers apart and then closed them around the staff. Anselm was carried into the church to shouts of acclamation and the singing of hymns, while he kept protesting, "Nihil est quad facitis." This is nothing, what you are doing. But however desperately Anselm may have wished that it all came to nothing, he was not to have his way, and by August of 1093, he had accepted the Archbishopric of Canterbury. It would prove to be a vexatious job in many ways, but he held it for the rest of his life. Besides being one of the crucial turning points of his life, Anselm's accession to the Archbishopric of Canterbury illustrates the multiple contexts in which his life and his work must be understood. He was a monk, committed to the rule of Saint Benedict and the rigorous demands it made. He wrote and taught within that monastic context, not as a freelance teacher who gathered students around himself. There were many such teachers in those days, but also not in one of the cathedral schools that would eventually develop into universities. He was a public figure who corresponded with monks and lay people alike, addressing matters of controversy, dispensing spiritual counsel, sometimes unasked for. As archbishop, he was drawn into the turmoil of church-state relations and was an important figure in the church's attempt to wrest control away from kings and nobles. Thanks to Lanfranc's teaching, he was initiated into the intellectual mainstream of his day, though he carried out his philosophical work in such an individual way that he broke intellectually, though never personally, with Lanfranc. I will examine these contexts, monastic, intellectual, public, and ecclesiastical, with a view to showing how understanding them sheds lights on Anselm's life and on his writings. The monastic and intellectual contexts. not even the most admiring of hagiographers, and we have such a person in the figure of Anselm's friend, disciple, and biographer, Aodmer, would pretend that Anselm had always been drawn to the monastic life. An intense desire at the age of 14 to enter a monastery, thwarted by the local abbot, soon faded. Anselm turned to ordinary pursuits, not particularly devout, but also not particularly dissolute, lest he displease his pious and doting mother, Ermengarda. When she died, around 1050, Anselm was bereft. Anselm's father, Gundulf, never the easiest of men to get along with, became unbearable. In 1056, they quarreled irreconcilably, and Anselm left the family home in Aosta to make a new life elsewhere. What exactly he was looking for, or indeed whether he was looking for anything in particular at all, is unclear. We know that he traveled through Burgundy, the Loire Valley, and Normandy, where there were both schools and monasteries of great renown, but we do not know whether he sought any of them out. After 3 aimless years, he at last found a direction. He went to Bec to study with the great Lanfranc. Lanfranc was prior of the abbey and the head of its school, which at that time was open to external pupils, sons of the nobility and gentry who were to be educated in the liberal arts for careers in a world that increasingly rewarded facility with the written word, as well as clerics eager to learn from someone who relit the light of the arts in the West, whom God raised up to be a guide and a light to lead the minds of the Latins. External pupils brought in money, and the abbey was prosperous. Lanfranc managed much of its external business and had become a trusted advisor to William, Duke of Normandy. Lanfranc's scholarly reputation was founded in particular on his mystery of dialectic, the use of techniques of linguistic analysis and logical argumentation to clarify philosophical problems and to elucidate answers. The great historian, William of Malmesbury, wrote that Lanfranc sent out his pupils into the world belching forth dialectic. There was something of a mini-renaissance of dialectic in the 11th century, although it's not entirely clear why. Generally, when a new burst of philosophical energy emerges, it has some discernible cause. New texts become available, new logical techniques are developed, scientific developments push people to think in new ways. But in the 11th century, people had all the same old texts, used all the same old logical techniques, made no new scientific discoveries of note. Yet for some, or no reason, there was a revival of dialectic, and Anselm came on the scene as the revival was in full flower. No doubt it was not the monastic life that drew him to Bec, but the opportunity to learn from the greatest of the dialecticians, Lanfranc of Bec, who might well be known as the preeminent figure of the 11th century intellectual scene if Anselm hadn't entirely eclipsed him. Anselm arrived at Bec in 1059. He fell into a sort of hero worship of Lanfranc, who in turn recognized Anselm's ability and soon gave him a share in the teaching. Anselm took quickly and naturally to the intellectual life that Lanfranc had created at Bec. The monastic life was more of a struggle. But after some hesitation, and one is tempted to say, a bit of self-created drama, Anselm did take his monastic vows in 1060. However tumultuous the path to commitment had been, the commitment itself was wholehearted and irrevocable. Monastic life shaped Anselm's thought in certain obvious ways. He developed arguments in conversations with fellow monks. He wrote some works at their request or for their use. His correspondence is filled with pastoral advice to monks and nuns about how to live out their monastic profession. More striking, however, are the ways in which his monastic embrace of obedience, authority, and common life arguably shapes even his treatises. For Anselm, there is freedom in obedience and the acceptance of authority. No longer a slave to his own desires, no longer burdened with the need to make his own way in the world, a monk attains the liberty to focus wholeheartedly on God. And this is true not only in the domain of action, but also, perhaps preeminently, in the domain of thought. Acceptance of theological authority is not a straitjacket. It does not inhibit creative thought, but sets one free to think about the deep things of God with confidence that one's thinking will not go off the rails. There is even a tantalizing suggestion in Anselm's letter on the incarnation of the Word that obedience, spiritual discipline, and meditation on Scripture, the core of the monastic life, can enable someone to experience the truths of faith. Experience, exterior, is a word Anselm uses for first-hand acquaintance with something. Sensation is a kind of experience. Through my power of sight, I experience something at first hand and know for myself that it is present. I can speak of it with confidence and clarity. I can knowledgeably invite others to experience it with me because I know where and what it is. If the obedient, disciplined, and meditative searcher experiences the truths of faith in an analogous way, this would mean that through the power of reason he would see those truths for himself. He could speak of them with confidence and clarity from the store of his own experience, and he could lead others, equally obedient, equally disciplined, along the meditative path by which they too could see the truth for themselves, as if at first hand. I hesitate to put too much weight on this one passage, for nowhere else in his treatises does Anselm speak of experiencing the truths of faith in this way. But the suggestion is instructive, because it captures so much of what is distinctive about Anselm's theological writing. Though faithful to authority, he almost never cites authority. Why cite someone else's testimony for a truth that you have been able to see on your own? Other people may have given you the maps, but you have explored the territory for yourself. Although Anselm's theological approach was, if my suggestion is correct, deeply rooted in and formed by his life as a monk, monks did not typically write in the way Anselm did, and some, most notably his old mentor Lanfranc, disapproved. Anselm sent his first major treatise, the Monologion, to Lanfranc, by then Archbishop of Canterbury, for his approval, assuring Lanfranc that he would make whatever changes Lanfranc requested and would even destroy the work if he thought it unworthy of publication. We do not have the text of Lanfranc's reply, but it is clear from Anselm's response that Lanfranc was unhappy that the Monologion had no citations of Scripture or the Church Fathers, particularly Augustine. Anselm defended himself. He had not said anything new, anything that couldn't be defended by quoting Scripture or Augustine, but he had wanted to present his own arguments as if discovering them for myself. Anselm made no changes to the work to accommodate Lanfranc, and he never submitted another work for Lanfranc's approval. He did, however, write a preface dedicating the work to Lanfranc, and the two remained friends. Even in this first major work, Anselm was going his own way. He would grow even more independent as the years went by. In his reply to Lanfranc, he protested that he hadn't said anything new and that he wouldn't have dared to say anything Augustine had not already said. 2 decades later, he would write that the truths of the faith are so deep, so inexhaustible, that of course not everything that could be said about them has already been said. The territory is vast, and Anselm will now openly acknowledge that he has explored parts of it that no one else had before. The monastic life that Anselm had chosen was also a communal life. He was not a hermit. He had briefly entertained that possibility before making his profession at Bec. But one of a body of men, all dedicated to the same end, and helping one another towards that end. Anselm had a remarkable gift for friendship, and in his early letters especially, he writes movingly and with great intensity of love for his brothers. In a letter to Henry, who had taken his vows at Bec in the early 1060s, but transferred to another house since that time, Anselm speaks of the longing that absent brothers rightly feel for each other, and he imagines the joy of reunion, whether in this life or the next. Some writers struggled with the idea that the joys of heaven are somehow communal. What can the fellowship of any human being add to the joy of seeing God face to face? But Anselm always builds friendship into his picture of the perfect life of heaven. In his consideration of the joys of heaven in chapter 25 of the Proslogion, he first invites us to ponder how everything we love, everything we desire as good, is found in God, the source of all good and fount of every blessing. What great joy is there where so great a good is present, he says. But there is still greater joy yet to be considered. O human heart, O needy heart, heart that has known troubles, that is indeed overwhelmed by troubles, how greatly would you rejoice if you abounded in all these things? Ask your inmost self whether it can even comprehend its joy at such great happiness. And yet surely if someone else whom you loved in every respect as yourself had that same happiness, your joy would be doubled, for you would rejoice no less for him than for yourself. And if two or three or many more had that same happiness, you would rejoice as much for each of them as you would for yourself, if you loved each one as yourself. Therefore, in that perfect charity of countless happy angels and human beings, where no one will love anyone else less than he loves himself, each one will rejoice for each of the others just as he does for himself. If, then, the human heart will scarcely comprehend its own joy from so great a good, how will it be able to contain so many and such great joys? This address to the human soul, embedded in a larger address to God, is noteworthy for more than its fervor and its embrace of communal life. It is also a striking piece of dialectic. It is an argument. It states premises and draws inferences from them. Even in his prayers, even while arguing that the joys of heaven are beyond our power of comprehension, Anselm is always engaging in dialectic, always making arguments, clarifying terms, proposing and solving apparent contradictions, separating not just the true from the false, but also the more complete truth from the less complete. To Henry, a monk of Bec, September 1070 to Spring 1073. Letter 5. To his dearest Lord and brother Henry, brother Anselm sends greetings. As much as your reputation, most beloved, testifies to me that your manner of life towards all is growing day by day towards nobility of conduct along with devout holiness, so much is the heart of your friend enkindled with a longing to see what he hears of with love and to enjoy what he loves to hear of. But because I have no doubt that your love for me is like mine for you, I am also certain that you long for me as I long for you. For those whose minds are fused into one by the fire of love are right to grieve if their bodies are separated by the places where they live. Yet because, whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord and not to ourselves, we must be more concerned with what the Lord, to whom we belong, is making of us than with what we, who are not our own, want. Let us therefore serve the longing of brotherly charity in such a way that we serve the dominion of his heavenly will. And let us so display the obedience of subjection demanded by his almighty governance that we preserve the affection of love lavished upon us by divine gift. For we will not be able to unite God's ordering with our own well-being any better than by willingly obeying his will in the arrangement of our own affairs. Furthermore, since both of us have brothers present with us whom we love and who love us in return, as we enjoy them with delight governed by reason, let us fit ourselves to enjoy them with reason filled with delight, and let us pray earnestly that some day we will be together with friends both present and absent to enjoy God himself in their company. For when by heavenly mercy we arrive by our various roads at the homeland for which we now sigh, we will rejoice all the more that we have been called back from our diverse places of exile and now come together. What distinguishes Anselm from Lanfranc and other 11th century figures is not that he uses dialectic, but that he uses it so pervasively. Every one of his treatises, even the proslogion, which has the literary form of a prayer, is composed almost entirely of arguments. Dialectic is the tool by which one explores intellectual territory for oneself. It generates the positive content that fills in the gap left by the absence of authoritative quotations so deplored by Lanfranc. Where other writers might use dialectic to clarify, elucidate, or defend theological claims, claims accepted on the basis of scriptural or patristic authority, Anselm also uses dialectic to establish the truth of those claims. He professes to other necessary reasons, in support of the doctrines of the Trinity, the Incarnation, and the Atonement, arguments that establish the truth of those doctrines by reason alone, with no need to appeal to authority. He offers those arguments as a pattern for meditating on the reason of faith, the original title of the Monologion. By the reason of faith, ratio fidei, Anselm means the intrinsically rational character of Christian doctrines in virtue of which they form a coherent and rationally defensible system. Christian doctrines are intrinsically rational because they concern the nature and activity of God, who is himself supreme reason and exhibits supreme wisdom in everything he does. And because human beings are rational by nature, we can grasp the reason of faith. The arguments themselves are not the reason of faith. They are a pattern, a template, for meditating on the reason of faith. It requires both dialectical skill and some measure of spiritual discipline to follow the template. But Anselm is confident that those who can follow it will come to see that what is believed on faith is not merely reasonable, not merely true, but beautiful. The public and ecclesiastical contexts. Anselm was always happiest when he could be both fully a monk and fully a dialectician in this way, but other responsibilities intruded. Lanfranc left Bec in 1063 to become abbot of the newly founded monastery at Caen, and Anselm was elected to succeed him as prior. In 1078, the saintly founder of the Abbey of Bec, Herluin, died, and Anselm was elected abbot. He found his new duties uncongenial, though he carried them out conscientiously and with reasonable success. He even managed to get some writing done. 3 philosophical dialogues: On Truth, On Freedom of Choice, and On the Fall of the Devil, written between 1080 and 1086. Anselm's great gift for friendship served the abbey well, extending its influence, increasing its prestige, and enlarging its possessions. The extensive secular business required by his role, involving money, lands, attendance at court, endless administrative work, and cultivating relationships with wealthy donors, was not to Anselm's taste. It all belonged to the world, which he had renounced when he became a monk. And yet it would be wrong to say that his heart wasn't in it. He believed he was doing God's will, and he genuinely loved those who belonged to his ever-widening circle of friends. He was greatly loved in return.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.